Good evening, everyone, and thanks for coming out on a nice Friday afternoon. My name is Randy Bluffstone, and I'm a professor of economics here at Portland State, and I direct the Institute for Economics and the Environment. I'd like to welcome you and those who are watching via live stream and those who will watch the presentation on the IE website a bit later. I've passed around some sign-in sheets, so don't feel obliged, but if you would like to receive notifications of future events, go ahead and sign the sheet if you haven't already, and put down your email, and we'll make sure that you're contacted when something's going on. Before introducing our speaker, I'd just like to spend a couple of links with the IE presentation last week that was given by James Boyd of Resources for the Future. Jim focused on some possible contributions that economics might make to help solve the climate problem. And he focused really on, I would say, on cost-benefit analysis, and especially on the benefit side of the equation. And in my kind of setup remarks, I mentioned kind of another area that, at least I thought, that economics has something to offer. And that's in the area of incentives, of trying to create instruments to encourage people to act in the public interest when maybe their personal interests don't correspond well with that public interest. This is a key problem in the economics of the environment. This kind of getting people to do the right thing, and this goes by a bunch of names. Sometimes it's called internalizing externalities. It's one way it's phrased. Another one is taking care of the global commons. You know, the global commons, sometimes you hear. Or another way it's often phrased is as collective action, engaging in collective action, engaging in work on behalf of the community as a whole, and paying some personal price for that. Okay, so these are kind of general concepts, I think, that are very important. And it raises the question of, well, how do you do that? You know, what are these techniques? What are these instruments that might be available to get people to act in that public interest, to make appropriate trade-offs when they're incurring costs and maybe there's no obvious reason that they should do it, right? Now, we deal with such issues every day. So today, as you see from the title and as you well know, we're going to be talking about the global commons, getting countries and regions and whole groups of people, big groups of people, to do the right thing. But let's face it, we face this every day ourselves, don't we? In the public policy arena and also what we're doing individually. So kind of to put you on the spot, you know, just think for a second, what have you done today to protect the global commons, to protect the climate? What have you done today? What explicit actions have you taken that maybe weren't strictly in your personal interest, but you did it for the climate? And I bet you can think of something, but I bet you can also think of something that you did that you knew harmed the climate, increased emissions, something. And sometimes when I raise this with students, people say some things like, well, you know, I could have walked, but I took the elevator. You know, something like that. There's a lot of possibilities, and I bet you can think of an example where you kind of made the calculation and said, I think I'm gonna do something that enriches me personally, saves me some cost, maybe gives me a little higher quality, maybe benefits me directly in some way. This is a normal type of trade-off that we often see. Now, so keep that in mind. Now, Sir Nicholas Stern, who is the British economist and author of a very, very influential study that came out in 2006, focusing on the costs and benefits of climate change, the costs of climate change and the optimal action. He described climate change as an externality. So you remember I talked about internalizing externalities. It's an externality with a difference. It's global, it's long-term, it's uncertain, potentially large and irreversible, with inequitable costs and benefits. So it's what I'm trying to say is it's a lot like what we experience every day on steroids. And I would add to that, it's also multi-leveled. We've got individuals that I'm trying to talk about a little bit here, but we also have the states, we've got countries, we've got the whole globe. And all we got pulled together, got to engage in collective action. So in principle, it's the same type of thing, but all these issues, all these things that make it an externality with a difference are challenges, are very serious challenges for climate change, for mitigating climate change, and for the collective action more generally. So one way to phrase this project in which the world is engaged in is to recognize the individual, regional, country level interests and incentives, but needing to create incentives for the globe to pull together, for the globe to engage in the collective action to save the climate, to stabilize the climate. Clearly, if we were to, you know, to somehow be able to envision this climate as somehow personal in our own interest, you know, probably we would, you know, it would be stabilized. And so that's a key piece of the challenge. But of course we need enticements, we need convincing, we need a variety of instruments. And this is the business, as I understand it, of the climate negotiations that have been ongoing and will reach a peak, really, in December in Paris. So I think Dr. Charles Kolstad is really an ideal person to help us kind of clue us in on this and help us understand this situation better. He's been very close to this process. He's a senior fellow at the Precourt Institute for Energy and also a professor by courtesy in the Department of Economics at Stanford. And he's also a senior fellow at the Environmental and Energy Policy Analysis Center at Stanford. He was a Peace Corps volunteer in Ghana, which I'd like to mention because I was also a Peace Corps volunteer. I think that's very, very important. Research interests focus on uncertainty and regulation. Most of his work in the area of climate change and energy markets. He's a convening lead author of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change and Working Group 3 of that. Former president of the Association of Environmental and Resource Economists and author of more than 100 publications, currently at Stanford, previously at University of California, Santa Barbara. And with that, I'd like to turn it over with pleasure to Charlie Kolstad. Please hold your questions. We'll take those at the end, but my colleague Dave Irvin will be passing around a mic and there'll be a half hour at least for questions. Thank you, Charlie Kolstad.
Well, thank you very much, Randy. It's great to be up here, and I took a hike in the Columbia River Gorge this morning, so I'm in an even better mood than normal. It's great to be here. So I'm going to talk about three things, but they're all connected. I'm going to talk about the president and what he's been doing about climate change, because this has been high on his agenda throughout his term. Now, it's not the only thing he's had to worry about, obviously, but it's been high on his agenda, and if you look at the 8 years in office, or I guess it's only seven now, every year, every couple of years, there's something major he's trying to do in climate change. Many have not succeeded, some have succeeded. Carbon, of course, is the overarching substance we're talking about. Carbon dioxide, greenhouse gases, climate change, all wrapped up together. And it's all coming together in this meeting that some of you, many of you probably are aware of in Paris. There's going to be a big meeting of, I think all 7 billion people in the world are going to be in Paris, as far as I can gather. To try to hammer out some sort of agreement on climate change. Now, note from this logo up here, it's COP21. So this is the 21st time they've been trying to do this. And prior to most meetings, there's a great deal of anticipation. And in the past, most of that has been dashed when the countries come out having agreed to next to nothing. But I think I'm optimistic about Paris, though, you know, what do I know? I'm optimistic because expectations have been tamped down a bit. And that's a good sign. When expectations are low, it's easier to be pleasantly surprised. And I think one of the problems we've had in the past is that we've tried to solve the entire problem in one fell swoop, go from doing nothing whatsoever to solving the problem, and you have to get unanimity on solving the problem. Well, you just know in your everyday life that when you're setting the bar so high, you're most likely going to fail. So they've been very realistic, I think, or much more realistic this time around, and we'll talk a little bit about that. This is the logo for the Paris, there's the Eiffel Tower right there, COP21, Conference of the Parties to the Treaty Framework Convention on Climate Change. I have no idea what CMP11 is, but it's in the logo. Okay. So the question is the climate right for action? Now, this is a city right next to me, Redwood City, and it's Palo Alto, Menlo Park, and Redwood City. And back in the 1920s, they declared that their climate was best by government test. It has to be true. It says it right there in the sign as you go into the city. And the question is the climate right now for action. So what I want to talk about is what has been happening internationally up to now. What did the IPCC, which is a group of experts really, that look at what we know about climate change and tries to synthesize it and tells the negotiators, look, these are the facts on the ground. Hopefully this will help you make a decision about what to do. What did the IPCC tell us or tell everybody that's relevant to solving the problem? The U.S., which is where we are, and it's on most people's minds in this room, what has the U.S. done in the past, and what is it doing differently now? And then, why all of a sudden is this coming together in Paris, and what's the significance of that? So that's the agenda for the hour, and I hope we get through it all. So, I'm at an oblique angle here, so I can't really read what's written there, so I will take out my glasses and read what's in front of me. There are really four slides that tell us the paint the picture of why things are the way they are. These are the top 10 emitters of the world. And you see, this is the, maybe I'll just stand in front.
China, India, United States, European Union, India, Russian Federation. These are two different years, and that tells
a story about where most of this is coming from. The whole world is contributing, but really there's a handful of countries that are doing most of it, and those are who they are. Now these are big countries. China's the leader, not because China's the most evil country in the world, but they've just got three times as many people as we do, and they got more people than anybody else. So they're bound to be high in this category. And so this tells you where the responsibility, so to speak, lies. If you go over here, we see the per capita emissions for top 10 emitters. Now, developing countries like China and India like to point to this graph, not the A graph. Because this graph says that the number one emitter is Canada, and the number two emitter in the United States, and the number three emitter the Russian Federation, and so forth down the line. This is the emissions per person. Now, in part, this is because Canada, the U.S. are these spread out countries. You know, we're not all concentrated in a very compact country where transportation is much more less difficult to just get from where you are to the next city. You know, if you want to go from Portland to Seattle, it's quite a trip. But if you want to go from Brussels to Paris, it's a much, much smaller trip. So that's per capita emissions from the top 10 emitters tells a slightly different story.
And this is the emission intensity of the top 10 emitters. Now, this is a metric that other folks, everybody likes the metric that puts their country in the best light, understandable. This is the emission intensity, this is the emissions per unit of GDP. And if this is CO2 per unit of GDP, and the Russian Federation is number one, China's number two, and the United States is out here. Essentially, we're a lot more efficient in producing our goods and services and don't require as much emissions, but we produce a whole pile of stuff, which is why we're so high in this particular category. But these other countries are really inefficient in how they produce, at least in terms of carbon. So this is sort of a third take. So you can either look at it as totals, you can look at it as per person, which is sort of has a fairness dimension to it, or you can look at it per unit of GDP, which has to do with the fact that if you're doing more, you'd expect more CO2. And then the final cut is this one here, which is the cumulative CO2 emissions sort of over all time. It's not quite all time, 1850 to the present. But this tells you, this is the United States right here, and this is the European Union. And this is China right here. So this is the standard story you get from some countries, particularly developing countries that are over in this category. Look, you, the U.S., Europe, you created this problem. Don't ask us to join you in fixing it until you make an effort to fix it. So all of these storylines have some relevance and have some substance to them, and they're used depending on different perspectives. Now, I should say that I'm not here to talk about how serious climate change is or, show you graphs of CO2 going up. That's another talk that Randy may have, or you probably already been to. Although I would note that the strongest hurricane on record in the Western Hemisphere is popped up this morning in the news, and it's not necessarily caused by climate change. But as a philosopher friend of mine says about causation, is you don't have to have deterministic cause and effect for something to be caused. If climate change raises the probability of a strong hurricane, then that's causation. So we got the hurricane, the ocean is warming up, it's an El Nino year, so that gives you some warmth, but also climate change is expected to do the same thing. Okay, so those four slides sort of give they don't tell you a story about why we need to solve the problem, but they tell you the story of why it's difficult to get countries on board to fix things. Everybody has a different perspective. So let's look back at what's happened internationally to give some context to where we are today. I don't know if I guess you can probably read that okay. I should say that the first couple of papers that talked about climate change being a serious problem were in the 1890s. So this is not a new problem, unless you consider 1890 to be relatively recent. But it sort of got underway in the 1980s. And in 1988, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change was established. And I already mentioned that, but here's a quote that says what it's supposed to do: to prepare based on available scientific information assessments of all aspects of climate change and its impacts with a view of formulating realistic response strategies. So it's really an important component to this process. In 1992, which some of the people that are my generation or not even of my generation will remember, there was a big Earth Summit in Rio. few decades ago, everything related to the environment was an Earth Day, an Earth Month, an Earth Year, or an Earth Summit. This was the Earth Summit, and everybody wanted something substantive come out of it. And one thing that did come out of it was the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, which is affectionately known as UNFCCC. And this, it's important to recognize that this is a bona fide treaty. This was ratified by the United States Congress for the American side of it, which those Americans in the audience know from your high school government or civics that you have to have a ratification of a treaty by Congress in order for it to go into effect. And this treaty was ratified. And most other countries in the world also ratified it using their own mechanisms. And every year since 1995, a conference of the parties has been held. COP1 was in Berlin, COP21 is in Paris. Now in 1997, COP3 resulted in the Kyoto Protocol to the treaty. So this was an agreement that came out of one of those COPs like the Paris one. This called for 6 to 8% reductions by 2012. So this is everybody in the world agreeing to this. It, as a protocol to the treaty, it then needs to be ratified by the signatories to the UNFCCC. The UN, in 2001, the US declared it was not going to sign the Kyoto Protocol. The Bush administration says it's ineffective, too costly, and the burdens are unfair. Now, the Bush administration got a lot of criticism for this, not so much from the right, but from the middle of the road and from the left. But the fact of the matter is a lot of countries didn't adhere in the end to the Kyoto Protocol either. They just weren't so vocal about it. It ends up being primarily a European Union activity. Not entirely, but primarily. In 2005, the EU launched its carbon emission trading system. Also, a lot of alphabet soup here, the EU ETS, emission trading system, based on the American success of our sulfur emission trading system from the 1990 Clean Air Act. And I should point out that I got these two guys up here. This, of course, is, anybody know who this is? Yeah, I mean, some people are post-Gore, I suspect, in the audience. But Al Gore was very active in this in the 1990s and even into the noughts. And this guy, who's this guy?
Bush
the elder. And he was responsible for the Rio, the UNFCCC. He was responsible for the sulfur allowance system. Where was that? The U.S. Sulfur Emission Trading System from the Clean Air Act that was the basis for the European action on carbon. He did a lot. And as a consequence, he gets his little picture up there. In 2007, the IPCC shares the Nobel Peace Prize, and this is it right down there. And that leads to increased credibility for them. And then in 2009, COP15 rolled around in Copenhagen. That was big news too. Pretty recent news, 6 years ago. And this is where the 2°C political goal came from. There's this goal floating around that's often accepted as gospel that we really got to keep the temperature increase down below 2°C. Well, that's really a political goal. It's not based on any analysis of any sort. It's just a target that the politicians grabbed onto as a way of really making action more immediate, necessary action more immediate. It's better, if your choice is to say, we got to do something about this, guys, the sooner the better. I don't have a date in mind, but just we got to do something. It's better to say, we have a specific target, 2°C, we got to do something to avoid reaching that. So this is where the 2 degrees came from. In 2014, now we're getting to where everybody remembers it, unless you're really old, then you don't remember 2014, like me. China and the U.S. signed an unprecedented agreement to reduce emissions. China and India have always been dragging their feet on this, saying, you guys solve the problem you created first, and then when you've done something, come back to us. And then earlier this year, we had the Pope's encyclical on climate change. How many people read the Pope's encyclical on climate change in this room? All right, good. I read it too. Everybody can read it. It's written in Popeese, so it's meant for the general public, except for the Latin part of it. But it's worth reading. It's worth reading. India announced its greenhouse reduction plan just a couple of days ago, or weeks. And also in 2015, we had the abandonment of the top-down in favor of the bottom-up negotiations. Now, what do I mean by that? In the previous 20 years, we've always wanted to get all the countries together. And, you know, just imagine everybody in this room agreeing to do something. But this room is small. You've got 180 countries. Each country has a delegation of a half dozen people or more. And they have to agree unanimously to do something. And finally, after not really being successful in 20 years, they decided to change the strategy. And the strategy this time around, fundamentally different. Each of you countries is told, tell us what you can do. You know, don't worry about us, don't worry about the others, don't worry about your neighbors. Tell us what you can do and what you can commit to. And then we'll just add them all up and see what we got. That's what I mean by the bottom up, and that's what we're doing this time. And that's why I think it's going to be a lot more successful. Okay, so that was the one of the bullets that at the beginning in that Redwood City slide. What internationally has been going on? So now I'd like to switch gears just a little and talk about what the IPCC told us in 2014. And, you know, it is 2015 now. I am talking about the recent past. But this year and last year were really kind of important years in this international climate negotiations. A lot has happened. And in 2014, a big IPCC assessment came out. It had been almost 10 years since the previous one. And there were a number of messages that came out of that, some of which, I mean, this thing is probably a foot thick, so I've condensed it down to one slide. The physical science says that, you can read this, the warming of the climate system is unequivocal, and since the 1950s, many of the observed changes are unprecedented over decades to millennia. The atmosphere and ocean have warmed, the amount of snow and ice has diminished, sea level has risen, and the concentration of greenhouse gases has been increased. So that's pretty clear. Secondly, they said each of the last three decades has been successively warmer at the Earth's surface than any preceding decade since 1850, which is about when we started reading thermometers and writing them down around the world. They call it the instrumental record, meaning their instruments to measure the temperature. In the Northern Hemisphere, 1983 to 2012 was likely the warmest 30-year period of the last 1,400 years. You might ask, well, how do they know what the temperature was in the year 700? One way they do it is they look at tree rings. They take a big old tree that's been out there for a long time, and they take the core, and they can tell from the tree ring, the precipitation anyway. They also take ice cores, and they can take an ice core from Greenland or something, and every year it snows, lays down like a tree ring in the ice core, and you can figure out how much it was in there. And there are other methods they use. So this, the second working group, physical and biological impacts, said that the changes in the climate have caused impacts on human systems on all continents and across the ocean. And then finally, working group three, the one I was working on, said achieving the 2-degree target will be very difficult and costly. In fact, they initially wanted to say it's impossible, but that was viewed as politically inappropriate, and they said, changed it to be very difficult and costly. So let me just go through a few slides with some interesting facts. First of all, 55% of the man-made CO2 emissions ever emitted are since 1970. Everybody in this room has been around at least part of that time in 1970, and many of you for most of the time since 1970. And this is where over half of the emissions ever emitted have come from. And if you think about waiting this out, let's wait till all the fossil fuel is gone. After all, everybody talks about peak oil, fuel disappearing. Far more carbon is in the ground than will ever be emitted over the rest of this century. So waiting it out, not gonna work. Most emissions growth, and this is 1970 to 2010, this is CO2 from fossil fuel combustion and from other uses. Most emission growth is from CO2 from burning fossil fuels. So there are other things, like the sheep in New Zealand that fart and send out methane. That's a little bit, not much. That's in this wedge here. CO2 from combustion of fossil fuels, the big one. Now this may be a little difficult to parse, but this is the decadal rate of change in emissions, this little triangle here. And it's been decomposed into four components. Part of the increase in emissions is due to population growth. Part of it is due to the fact that we get richer. Part of it has been moderated by the fact that GDP per capita has, or energy intensity of GDP, you know, the amount of energy to produce a dollar has gone down because we've become more efficient. And part of it is because the carbon intensity of energy has actually gone down. Now if you trot along here, you notice that one thing has changed over the last decade is that we've stopped decarbonizing the energy supply, and it's now becoming more carbon intensive. So that's a worrying change. Now this is an important slide. This talks about the costs of achieving different targets. Now, how many people know about 350 ppm, the organization 350? Okay, this is 450 ppm. 350 isn't even on this. 450 ppm is the 2-degree target, more or less. This over here is more like 4 degrees. The ppm is the parts per million in the atmosphere of carbon, CO2 equivalent. So this is the 2-degree target, which everybody is sort of keying on as taking aggressive action. 350 is really even more aggressive action. So let's look at the results of the cost of trying to achieve the 450, the 2-degree target. Well, what these three lines are for is the year 2030, 2050, and 2100. So focusing on 2100, it says that it's going to take somewhere between 3 and 12% of our incomes to control the emissions to achieve this particular level. So that's quite a bit. 10% of our income in the U.S. would be about $2 trillion per year. And it's certainly something we could do, but it's a lot of money. And it ramps up. It's less in earlier years. Achieving more modest goals is still going to be expensive, and certainly may well be worth doing, but we need to be cognizant of the costs involved. And furthermore, and this is important, no matter what your objective, if you delay for another year or 2 years or 5 years, the costs are just going to go up. I mean, we know that from our everyday life. If you put off doing, you know, your roof's beginning to leak, you put it off, and you know it's going to actually just increase your cost if you do that. Okay, so let's turn to the good old US of A. And who's this guy here? Lyndon Johnson, yes. And on November 5th, 1965, the president's, the White House published a report warning that climate change was a serious problem and the country needed to do something about it. Now, this is coming from Lyndon Johnson's panel on pollution. There's a fairly substantial section on climate change. And when you read it, it's really prescient about what's coming now. So we've been working at this a while. But even when you go back before that, Charles Keeling, University of California, started measuring CO2 on Mauna Loa. That's of course, one of the two big volcanoes on the island of Hawaii, in the state of Hawaii. And the idea is that it's out there in the middle of the Pacific. No cities are going to futz up the measurement. And surprisingly enough, we don't know how much carbon was in the atmosphere prior to 1958. That's when we started to measure it accurately. And we know that it goes up like clockwork every year. In fact, you can see it going through cycles of summer, winter, and fall, and spring every year. It's 1965, I already talked about President Johnson. 1970s, interestingly enough, there was a real concern about global cooling. In fact, these two covers of Time magazine are from that period. You know, how to survive the coming ice age, the big freeze. And this global cooling was because people had proposed supersonic airline travel, like the Concorde. That was the only one that survived this. And there would be a lot of soot put into the stratosphere from these soot and particulates from these supersonic transports, which would shade the Earth and lead to this cooling. That was the big concern there. So we're moving right along. In 1988, we had a really hot summer in the US. Most of you probably don't remember the summer of 88 specifically. But it's surprising. It's hot outside, everybody thinks about global warming. It's cool outside, everybody thinks, well, what's the problem? You know, where's all your global warming, Kolstad? That's just human nature. In 1988, there was a real hot summer. This was the rise of concern over global warming among the population. Had congressional hearings, and bingo, Congress established a big research program with $1 to $3 billion a year to research climate change, global warming back then. And that's been going on every year, throughout the Bush administration years, Obama administration, Clinton administration. A lot of money has gone into that. The 1990s, I already mentioned the IPCC being set up in 1988, that was international, the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change in Kyoto, But there was also the Byrd-Hagel resolution in 1997. This was just before Kyoto, and this was a resolution that passed the U.S. Senate unanimously, and it said, it instructed the negotiators in Kyoto that we would not agree to anything that didn't meet two requirements. No climate agreement that doesn't meet two requirements. One requirement was that by the U.S. signing it, we wouldn't actually be making ourselves worse off. So it has to be individually rational, to put it in economic speak, for the U.S. to go into it. They need to see themselves as actually being better for signing the agreement. And presumably, if it's a good idea, every country can be better for signing the agreement. So that's number one. Number two, everybody in the world, or most of the big developing countries, had to agree to do something. And those were two big requirements that essentially killed any prospect of the U.S. ratifying the Kyoto Agreement.
Question, I'm curious. Did they figure out the cost of not doing it, or did they just look at the cost of doing it?
Oh, they didn't look at anything. This is a sense of the Senate resolution. They were just instructing the negotiators, don't agree to anything that ends up the U.S. writing the checks for the rest of the world, and make sure everybody's participating. Actually, not bad, although it's a bad first step. First steps, usually, you take baby steps first, then you take big steps like that. Let's see, where are we? We're about to get into the next century. 2001, the Bush administration withdraws the U.S. from the Kyoto Protocol. This guy here, who's he? John McCain, another hero in this area, believe it or not. He was responsible for a series of pretty strict legislation in Congress to set up a cap and trade system for carbon in the United States, him and Lieberman. And this was introduced and voted on a number of times, never quite passed. This is before, I guess he saw the light in when Obama got elected. In 2006, the California Global Warming Solutions Act, which is the cap and trade system in California, and I understand, I'm talking to people here, that Washington State and Oregon are seriously considering trying to get some sort of carbon tax in legislated, either through ballot initiative or through the legislature. British Columbia has one, and a few other places do. 2007, the Supreme Court found that the Clean Air Act applied to greenhouse gases. Now, this is really, really, really important because it said you got a law in the books. It was passed in 1970. Actually, it was passed in 63, but revised since then. It says you can regulate greenhouse gases. You don't need another law, which is a very powerful result. And nevertheless, in 2009, when President Obama was first in office, he tried to introduce a cap and trade system called the Waxman-Markey Bill. And it passed the House successfully, you know, one of these squeakers. If you remember what was going on with the Affordable Care Act back in the early part of Obama's administration, you had to really work hard to get that one extra vote to get it through. Well, it got through, but it died in the Senate. And where am I? In 2011, the Obama administration promulgated really strict fuel economy standards. So it's taken a different route. Can't do Waxman-Markey, can't do a nationwide cap and trade system. So let's talk about addressing it piecemeal. So they put in really strict fuel economy standards to get our cars more efficient. And it's going up to 50 miles per gallon within 10 years. So just think about, you know, how are you going to get your F-150 to get 50 miles a gallon? It's going to be a real challenge. in 2014, but it went through anyway. 2014, the Clean Power Plan was proposed, and this is basically under the Clean Air Act. And today is also a propitious day for that, because today is the day it goes into effect. It was published in the Federal Register this morning, and it goes into effect today now, which also means that all the lawsuits are being filed today by all sorts of folks, including these guys here, that are really irritated at the Clean Power Plan. I'll talk a little more about that. And in 2014, I already talked about the historic Chinese-U.S. agreement, and that brings us to 2015 and Paris. So let's talk about the Clean Power Plan now. Enough of this sort of going through history on this. Is this, as Mitch McConnell says, a war on coal? Well, actually, it is a war on coal. It's true, because coal is really the culprit in this thing. I mean, particularly for first steps, it's coal that's the problem. So let's. So first of all, I have to go over here. Where does the U.S. CO2 come from? This is electricity, and this is transportation. Forget about the other stuff. Electricity is like a third of our CO2, something like that. So the Clean Power Plan focuses on that sector. The fuel economy standards focused on that sector. How do we generate our electricity? Well, this is coal here, this slice here. About half of our electricity is generated from coal. And then the rest is nuclear and natural gas and renewables. And this is power sector CO2, and this is what it was in 2005, this is what it was in 2010, and this is where it's projected to be under the Clean Power Plan. This is where it would be without the Clean Power Plan. And this you can thank fracking for. Basically, natural gas became much cheaper and put coal out of business in a lot of areas. This is all our power plants. So I'll put this down. These are all our power plants around the country. We even got some in Oregon here. But most of them are back here. But this is really the key. This is emission factors, which is pounds of CO2 per 1,000 kilowatt hours. Coal in its various forms, 700 or so pounds of CO2. Oil, about 600, natural gas about 400. So a lot of what President Obama is proposing is let's move from here down to here and magically cut our CO2 emissions in the power sector dramatically. And we, you know, are the lights in here from CO2, from or the Columbia River, from nuclear, from coal? Who knows? Electricity is electricity. So it's the kind of thing that is the perfect political solution and that nobody in the population, that's you and me, will notice anything's happened, except when we open our electric bill, possibly. But it's not actually that, but because of fracking, that's not too big a surprise either. So what they've set up in the Clean Power Plan is very ambitious. Each state has a goal stipulated by the EPA, a percent reduction by 2030 relative to 2012. And the light-colored states, 0 to 10%, that's Idaho, looks like the only one. Oregon is in the 20 to 30% category. California's in the 10 to 20% in large part because they've already done a lot of this. Kentucky, Mitch McConnell's home state, 40 to 50% reduction in CO2 emissions. And some of these other black or dark blue states have the same thing. So it's a very heterogeneous set of targets, which is one reason why there's a lot of objection to what's been done. The reason for that is the EPA went through every single state and said, you know, if I were doing this, what opportunities are there to reduce carbon emissions? And I'm just going to look at very straightforward things like switching to natural gas, and I'm going to see how much this state can achieve, and that's going to be the basis of the target. So each state is given this target, and then the states are told, you figure out how to reach it. I'm not going to tell you. You figure it out. And these are the ways the states could reduce their CO2 emission. They can make their power plants more efficient. They could retire some really heavy polluting power plants. Fuel switching, that's going to natural gas from coal. Increased use of renewables. Increased use of combined heat and power. I don't know if Portland does that, but if you have a power plant here, take the waste heat and heat houses with it, or send it to a factory. Increased use of biomass, increased use of nuclear. Nuclear figures into this. Energy efficiency, get rid of those old refrigerators. Electricity and transmission and distribution improvements. Move the energy around. Carbon capture and use for other purposes, or carbon capture and storage. These two things are pie in the sky, really. They have it yet to work, but there's a lot of hope being pinned on them. This is where you take the carbon out of the smokestack and stick it somewhere. The problem is we don't have a place to stick it. And people are really trying hard to figure that out. This is a timeline. This was when the plan was announced, you know, went into effect today. 2016, states have to make the initial submittal. 2018, states with extension submit the final plan. 2022, compliance period begins. And 2030, CO2 emission goals are met. Okay, so what's next for the Clean Power Plan? Legal challenges, real problem. State refusals to file plans. Back in the early 70s, Ohio refused to cooperate regarding sulfur, and the Fed stepped in and submitted their own plan for them. Non-compliance may be an issue. State may say it's going to do something, but not do it. Will it work? Well, you just have to look at this graph here. This is U.S. coal company market capitalization. You go to the New York Stock Exchange, they'll tell you how much each company is worth. They'll tell you there are 1,000 shares of Peabody Coal out there, and each one is worth $10. That means Peabody Coal Company can be bought for $10,000. Now, it's quite a bit more expensive than that. It was just an example. But the market capitalization of coal companies, all of them together in the U.S., has dropped. In 2011, it was almost $50 billion. And in 2015, it's dropped to $12 billion. So that's what people think about the prospects for the coal industry. That's what people that know the industry. So if anybody in here is particularly well off, there may be somebody. $12 billion is spare change. Bill Gates, he has $12 billion kicking around. He could buy the U.S. coal industry and shut it down. Problem solved. Not entirely, but. Okay, so finally, let me talk about Paris. And, Paris is wonderful. I'm looking forward to going to this meeting myself, actually. The core innovations are that for this, as I've hinted at, is that these INDCs, which is another acronym you may hear a bit. It's called Intended Nationally Determined Contributions. And these are the pieces of paper that every country files with the UN. And there's a web page, you can go and look at the INDC for every single country that's filed so far. And almost all of them have filed, except for maybe some small ones. And the big question is whether this will lead to anything. Now, I was listening to NPR the other day, and they had this great metaphor for the Paris, or for the climate negotiations. So I'm shamelessly stealing the metaphor from them, but it says it's like paying the tab for a group at a bar. I mean, all of us have gone in with a group. Some people, you know, drink like there's no tomorrow. Some people sip something. Some people have a soft drink. Some people come late. Some people come early. So the question of the tab shows up, how do you split it? Well, in the past, basically, we tried to come up with an agreement on how to split it based on how much you drank and your ability to pay. Now, everybody's just throwing some money in. And we all know that works better. The only problem usually is what? It doesn't add up. That's the big problem. But, you know, at least you get part of the bill paid.
That's
a very subtle point, because if everybody is voluntarily making this contribution, presumably it's their assessment of what they think is fair for themselves to do, because fairness is probably part of it. If you had a glass of water, you wouldn't think it's fair just to split it fractionally, but you'd probably put a little bit in, and I don't know if that would be fair, but it's not going to add up. We do know that. So let's look at the U.S. INDC. It's blessedly, never seen anything from the U.S. government that's 3 pages in length. It says that we're going to be 26% to 28% below 2005 and 2025. We'll cover all of our emissions, and these are the two laws that we will use. And no use of markets. And this graph may look familiar. It's the one I showed with the Clean Power Plan. These are, except this is all U.S. emissions. This is where we've been since 1990. And this is what we propose to do by the year 2025, which is our plan. Let's take a look at China's INDC. How about the translation of it? By 2030, China commits to achieve peak emissions of CO2 and hopefully do it earlier than 2030. They also, maybe more meaningfully, want to lower greenhouse gas emissions per unit of GDP by 60 to 65%. Now, China's economy is more than double, is expected to more than double by 2030. So, you know, in order to start bringing your CO2 down, you have to be reducing your carbon intensity of your GDP by more than your economy is getting bigger. And that we'll see about that. Also, interestingly, they want to increase forest stock volume by 4.5 billion cubic meters relative to 2005. So is this progress? Well, you could say no. This is woefully unambitious. But you could also say maybe. There's no legislation to implement these goals, so who knows if we'll get there. But I like to be positive and say that China's never before recognized that it might join the world in limiting emissions. This is big. And next year, we'll get them to be a little more aggressive. Now, how do all these INDCs add up? This is 1990 to 2015 for the world, not just one country, for the world. And this blue is where we would expect things to go if nobody did anything. And this green is, let's see, this is, I figured this out before, but one of these is 2 degrees and one of them is a degree and a half. I think they... Okay, where does it say that? Oh, down here, right. This yellowish one is 2 degrees and the green one is 1.5. So this, two degrees, 1.5, that's probably more consistent with the 350 ppm, I'm guessing, I'm not sure. But this pink line is where all the INDCs are. So, you know, it's certainly not solving the problem. It's not getting us close to what a lot of people want. But in the past, we've come away from these COPs being right on the blue line. And now we seem to be making some substantial progress. And we're going to do this every year, so that's what makes me hopeful about this. So in conclusion, climate change, I think what's different now is it finally seems to be resonating around the world. It's not just a bunch of policy wonks saying we got to do something about it. It's becoming, the voices are becoming louder. We're hearing from all quarters, companies, you'd expect to oppose it. They're doing things, individuals. Global action is not logical or concise. It's not well organized. But we do seem to be muddling through, at least if you take that small, on the previous graph, that small gain. The U.S. does have its ups and downs, but in comparison with almost any country, we should be viewed as one of the leaders in emissions reduction, international cooperation, and R&D into this problem.
What is R&D?
Research and development.
Thank you.
The bottom-up INDC process seems to be accomplishing something. And remember, all these countries are sovereign, which means nobody can tell them what to do. They have to go into this voluntarily. The INDCs being submitted for COP21 Paris are first step. If they work, subsequent ones may ratchet down the emission ceiling. Thank you.
Questions?
Thanks. I'm Jeff Goble. That was great. I appreciate that. What's interesting to me is where 2010, 2015 is, we're already seeing climate impacts, effects. And so if we went to zero emissions today, we still got problems. So it's an interesting thing that it's really important that we deal with the future stuff, but how do we deal with that carbon accumulation and what it's already doing to, like, Patricia and what was in South Carolina 2 weeks ago and the mudslides in California a week ago or whatever? You know, just we're getting, you know, so it's an interesting thing to think about is that part.
Yeah, you're right. I don't want to be pessimistic, but we're not going to go back to the way we were 200 years ago in terms of the climate. We've that boat has left. The problem is avoiding even worse consequences or significantly worse consequences. A number of economists have said, the small changes that we're seeing now, or the changes we're seeing now are small in comparison with what we should really be worried about, and that's the possible catastrophes that could come our way, such as shutting off the Gulf Stream. There's a whole list of climate catastrophes. Now, those would be significant. I think the main point is that whatever we decide to do, we're going to live with a changed climate. We just don't want it to be too changed. That's really the goal. Let's keep it from changing much. Try to eventually we'll bring this under control, but it's going to be a long time.
You mentioned the technology to pull carbon back.
Sequestration? Yeah.
But the S slide that says it's not real practical or something like that. But what's really interesting is that the Earth was a pretty dominant carbon a billion years ago, and in the atmosphere, and that has shifted to where dominant nitrogen and oxygen. So what did that? I mean, it wasn't human technology. So, you know, this ability of plants is just amazing. You just underestimate what we can do with that. Now Leah talked about just rearranging what we do with the way we affect plants can increase, significantly increase carbon capture. So it's another interesting piece. Yep. In fact, Rodale said... Rodale said...
Let some other people ask questions.
Rodale said 2011, if we could farm like they do, we could pull 111% of the 2011 emissions out of the atmosphere, and that's an interesting thing.
Yeah. Very interesting.
May I ask, if you're going to ask a question, wait until you get the microphone so that everybody can hear you online as well as here in the audience. Thank you.
Hi, Jim Panko, Chemistry and Engineering. So one of the things that you didn't talk much about, or at all really, about is the role of litigation. Since a lot of progress has been made, again, you know, in tobacco, you know, eliminating or reducing tobacco use, or even in Clean Water Act or Clean Air Act is litigation. So it might be difficult, given that there are sovereign nations involved, but there certainly is possibilities of litigation against multinational companies by people in the United States.
Well, that's certainly a good point, and it was effective against tobacco, or at least a lot of money was delivered by the tobacco companies. They still seem to be doing okay. But I went to a conference quite a while ago where the lawyers in the audience were saying the big fear among a lot of companies or some power companies is that there'll be some climate disaster somewhere in the world and they will sue a emitter of carbon and claim that you, the emitter of carbon, were contributing to the climate accident, whatever it is, and that would open a floodgate of litigation. I'm not aware that that's happened, but you know I could be wrong about that. So I don't have an answer to that, but it's a very interesting observation.
Thank you for a very interesting talk. I was wondering the analysis you showed about the percent of income that it would require to the 2-4% to offset, to mitigate climate. Mm-hmm. I think maybe that was from the IPCC Working Group 3. Was there also an analysis there of the costs of inaction, or was it primarily looking at how much it would cost
this
to
one here?
Hit 450 ppm? Yeah.
There was not an analysis of the cost and inaction. We tried to get the impacts group to do that, but they're mostly biologists, and they were not interested in that. They were interested in the physical consequences of inaction, which is were documented extensively. And perhaps there was a fear that if there was a toting up of the cost of inaction, that there would be an attempt to match up the two things, and I'm not sure what the fear was. Anyway, that didn't happen. And you got to recognize that the IPCC is a enormous enterprise, and it's very difficult to coordinate the action in one part of the IPCC with one other part of the IPCC. So it's sort of like a big old supertanker. Once it's got its direction it's going in, that's where it's going. And I totally agree with you, that would be an excellent addition. And in fact, I co-authored a science article a couple of weeks ago in which we called exactly for that the IPCC should be looking at all sides of the policy question, the cost of action and the cost of inaction. Or actually, more specifically, even if you act, there'll still be damages, as we were talking about earlier. And those are costs as well.
Next question.
My name's Tom Brunig. I work in the clean technology sector. Bill Gates recently had an interview in the Atlantic magazine that you may have seen where he talked about basically waging a large climate war with massive government subsidies and just pumping a whole lot of money into research and innovation. And I'm wondering how much you feel the government agencies around the world are doing to really bring in that innovation in terms of, you know, Europe has Eureka, the U.S. has its national labs and so on. How much is going on in that sector and how much is government trying to bring those private parties in?
Well, I think government is trying. I think the U.S. is probably the leader in this, you know, the billions we've been pumping into it. But I think that it's very difficult to get innovation in an area where the carbon is unregulated. It really dilutes the incentives to invent something that will save carbon. And it really will be greatly facilitated if we can make carbon, you know, I'll just say more expensive. Now that can be done through lots and lots of ways, but there's got to be a premium on not emitting carbon, and we don't have that now. We just talk about it. And when there's a premium on it, the innovators are going to see much more return to what they're working on, and that will do wonders. Historically, government-funded science has worked best in basic sciences and hasn't worked so well in trying to commercialize things. And there is a bit of basic science we're talking about here, you know, battery sciences, for instance, or sequestration. But a lot of it is commercialization of ideas, and the government funding is less useful. You really want to incentivize the private sector to pick up the ideas and take them all the way to the market. And it's hard to do if carbon's free. I mean, if people only talk about it.
Yeah, actually, my question is kind of similar to his. So that was kind of my thing. Like, I think the kind of obvious solution is that, I mean, I know it's obvious, yeah, but is focusing more on like nuclear energy. Like, I know like nuclear fusion, I mean, you're talking about, I know that's like years away, but I know the government's already putting in, there's like a massive coalition of people like the ITAR or something. It's like the International Thermonuclear Reactor. I think Lockheed Martin is like working on like a small nuclear reactor, a fusion reactor. So it's like, is all of this stuff kind of, I don't want to say much ado about nothing, but like in like 100 years or something, if we get like fusion technology or more fission technology, like it'll kind of, I feel like it'll just kind of go away on its own, even if it takes a little longer. I know there's like a lot of like uncertainty in the forecasting of how bad the climate's going to be, you know? Like like everyone agrees that climate change is a thing, but they don't know like how much or how.
So you think technology will solve all of this?
That's kind of my thing. So I mean, that's what I'm wondering is like why, kind of back to his question, is really like,
A lot of people are optimistic about technology, but I'll come back to the point I just made. If there's no payoff to inventing a better technology, where are the innovators? And fusion is just a full employment act for physicists, as far as I'm concerned, because it doesn't work. We have a zillion technologies that work, they're just not economic. I mean, even sequestration works. We can pump CO2 into geologic formations. We can make limestone out of CO2 and put a pile of limestone on the ground or bury it, but they're uneconomic. So I would, that's what I mean by commercialization. I think that we really need to move to incentivize the people that can make these things work better. And without doing anything about carbon, a lot of money will just go down the drain in terms of research and development. And I'm not quite as optimistic as you are.
even though I think all of us in our heart know that, you know, these magical technologies are always showing up, you know. Simple as the iPhone or the personal computer, you know, we don't know. Obviously, there's going to be inventions over the next century, but to expect it's going to solve all our problems, they've been researching that for 70 years now. So maybe if we wait, how about we're waiting 1,000 years? Then it might work.
Okay.
So my question relates to, I think I could adapt to huge changes in temperature and rain and all that, but I need to have clean water, fresh water, and food. So I'm wondering, can you talk a little bit about how climate translates into these things? You know, you look 40, 50 years in population, it feels like food and water are going to become super major issues, and they're very entangled with the climate.
Well, people as individuals are pretty adaptable. I mean, people have been moving from Minnesota to Los Angeles for decades. And the climate change for them is much, much greater than we're talking about here. And, you know, a lot of them are now moving to Oregon. But, you know, moving people around, people are really adaptable. And, but a lot of other things are not. All of our capital, you know, the city of Portland, you can't go pick that up and move it somewhere. Now, if climate change is slow, that may not be a problem. But if it's relatively quick, that's going to be a real problem. Also, ecosystems. You know, maybe a bird can pick itself up and fly somewhere else, but you can't move a forest overnight quickly, and it's very difficult for an ecosystem to reestablish itself in a new location. So, but people are very adaptable. Now, the food and water, clean water is not really a problem, as long as it's still raining. We use a lot more water than we really need to. I mean, here I am from California, and everybody knows that. Food, I don't have an opinion on that, but I suspect that agriculture is really intensive in certain parts of the world, and they get a great deal of agriculture goods out of small areas of land. So I'm less worried about that. I'm really worried about catastrophes, you know, things that we're not even talking about here. And we all know they're going to happen. We just don't know what they're going to be. But we know if we really screw up the climate, something's going to happen. But it's really hard to put our finger on it. That's what I'm more worried about than it being a little warmer in Palo Alto, which it has been this summer. That's not great, but it's not the end of the world, but some of these big changes will be. But I don't have anything definitive to say about that. That's a very dismal note, isn't it?
I have a two-part question, if that's all right.
Yeah, who, I can't see. Oh, okay.
So the first part of my question is, I hear a lot about what Western nations need to do in terms of combating climate change, and certainly we use more energy per capita. However, population growth in Western nations has mostly leveled off, especially in the last few decades, and we're seeing massive explosions of population growth in developing nations. Those people are going to need cheap and easily accessible energy to have any sort of standard of life. What is the IPCC doing to curb population growth in these areas of high energy demand? And the second part of my question is, has the IPCC looked at thorium-based nuclear reactors? Because I've heard a lot of energy around that in terms of that being a potential solution.
Well, to answer your second part of that, the IPCC, I'm sure, has looked at the thorium nuclear reactors. There's a section of the report on nuclear power. I can't cite to you what they say in there. What is the IPCC doing about population growth and cheap energy in the developing world? Well, you know, this is a little bit of a debate in the IPCC. First of all, the IPCC doesn't do anything about anything. It reports on what we know. But a lot of folks, particularly from the developing world, said, look, we have to have cheap energy to develop, but we also have to reduce the amount of energy we use. And you You know, I said, don't we want to make it energy expensive so people don't use as much?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's this really conflict between, do we want cheap energy? If you have cheap energy, people are going to waste it. That's what we do. That's what we Americans have done for a long time. Cheap energy, you waste it. That's what cheap means. And if you want people to conserve it, you make it more expensive. I mean, really what we want for the developing world is intelligent development that takes place. It doesn't necessarily mean that they have to follow the same path that we've followed to get where we are. They don't have to have sprawling cities, although they seem to be going that way. They could have more compact cities where transportation costs are not so great. There are technological solutions to save on energy. So I don't really buy into the fact that we have to provide more and cheap energy to the developing world. But that's not my choice. The developing world has its own theories about how it wants to develop, and every country is different.
You've mentioned several times the importance of pricing carbon, that if something's free, we just use more of it. We've got a couple models out there. We've got cap and trade in California, carbon taxes in other places, possibly here in Oregon. Or which of those is better, or is there a third solution that I'm not thinking of?
Well, I think that if a carbon tax can get through the legislature or whatever it has to get through, I think that's probably the best. Because it's simple, clear, and manageable. A cap and trade system, its main virtue is that it seems to be more, at least historically, has been more politically palatable, particularly if you give away the permits. And as a result, you can sort of through the back door get a price on carbon because the permits will be trading for a value. But the problem is, if you look at the Waxman-Markey bill, it was a 2,000-page bill, and it was larded up with so many exceptions and special treatments that cap and trade sort of morphed from a relatively simple idea to a very complicated system that almost died of its own weight in the national government. All the interests were trying to shape it, and it resulted in something that was unmanageable. A carbon price such as people in Oregon and Washington have been talking about, or some people have, and they use in BC, I think it has a virtue of being clean and transparent. The problem is that you bring in a lot of revenue with a carbon price, and there's a real temptation to earmark that revenue for pet projects. Could be environmental pet projects, it could be somebody else's pet project. That really defeats a lot of the gain you get from a carbon tax. Really, the best thing is either use the revenue to offset some other tax. I mean, you don't have a sales tax here, but you do have a regressive income tax. So you could reduce the income tax in Oregon with the revenue, or you could give the revenue back. Or you could just dump it in the general fund and let everybody compete for it like they do for other things. The risk with carbon tax is that it gets earmarked, and that defeats a lot of the gain from it. But it works, you know, it works well.
Thank you. One thing that I found curious was that one of the mitigation strategies listed was that of biomass. And a recent article came out saying that a lot of Europe's renewables were coming from biomass, and that there might be errors in accounting for those emissions, because on one end, it's not a carbon dioxide free source of energy, but it's also removing trees in order to generate the product to create that energy. And so I'm curious as to why we think of that as a mitigation strategy for carbon dioxide.
Well, that's a good question. The general concept is that biomass is just, it grew by sucking CO2 out of the air earlier this year, or maybe last year, and now we're putting it back in, so it's really a wash. It's not a fossil source of CO2, so that's much better. But you're right that not all biomass is created equal. It could be from growing fields of annual crops that are turned into biomass. It could be, which seems pretty reasonable if it's can be done efficiently and at a cost, appropriate cost. You could also think of diverting things like corn into biomass, taking it out of the food supply. And a lot of people have a lot more trouble with that. You know, here you have a perfectly good source of whatever corn is a source of, high fructose corn syrup is the only thing. You know, a perfectly good food that's being turned into a fuel. And then you could have cutting down trees, which take years to grow, to make the biomass. So, you know, it's not really a homogeneous thing. And I would agree with you that some are better than others.
Thank you. I'm wondering, coming into the upcoming Paris talks, there's such a variety in size of countries that are represented, and some are impacted much more so by climate change than others, looking at small island nations compared to larger developed nations. And I'm wondering how some of these smaller nations who are have less GDP, are not as prominent on the global, in the global view of who we're paying attention to, how they can really articulately express their somewhat more dire need to have drastic climate mitigation take place, because with sea level rise, the smaller island nations are much more impacted than our larger countries.
Yeah, that's a real good question. I mean, one of the disadvantages of this new approach, this bottom-up approach of asking everybody, what are you going to contribute to reducing emissions? If you're a small island state, you got nothing to say. You just hope everybody else contributes a lot, because you've got virtually no emissions of your own. You're just a victim. They have set up other mechanisms for compensating countries, well, for helping poor countries adapt to climate change. This is sort of the term that's used. If the climate changes, there are things you can do to sort of make it not quite so bad for yourself. Now, if you're an island and you're going underwater, well, about all they can give you is some airline tickets, I guess, but a lot of other damage is not quite so dramatic. And so they've set up a global environment fund, and there are other mechanisms that have been set up. But that's a real good question. I don't know how that's being addressed in this particular round, and it should be.
One more question.
So I just wanted to address the problem of putting all of our eggs in one basket. So basically, we're looking at all these technological innovations and just advancements, and we're saying, we're basically looking for these one time, or like these one fixes, almost like really focusing on one particular solution, or not really just one, but you know, a select handful that we choose to look at. And they're cost ineffective because we're trying to apply these solutions to a very wide range of problems to which some of them aren't as effective as others. And I feel that there needs to be a multitude of innovations that's backed by multitudes of investors and investments, but this needs to be supported by a more responsible financial sector, because you don't really want to end up, like, you don't really have that support if the financial sector is really tied up in private interests where there is no incentive to reduce carbon emissions. And my question is, like, how would you propose creating incentives for them to do such a thing?
You know, making carbon expensive is a pretty straightforward way of creating that private incentive. Although I guess I would, I mean, we all know that Wall Street looks after their own interests pretty well, and nobody else's. So, you know, I'm no friend of Wall Street. But they were the ones that told Texas Utilities, TXU, don't you build any more coal plants, we're not going to finance them because they're bad investments. They're the ones that have caused the value of coal mines to drop because they're bad investments. And they're the ones that are telling firms, cut back on your CO2 emissions in the future because that's a better investment than just being the last one out of the box on this. I mean, they're doing this for very selfish reasons because they think they're going to be financially better off by doing that, but they're certainly paying attention to carbon because they see that's the way the world is going, and they don't want to invest in things that will be stuck, left hanging when the world starts doing things about it. So the financial sector, I think, nothing does it like a price on carbon. But they're all, but even absent that, they're saying there's a likelihood there's going to be a price on carbon, and because of that, we're going to act now.
Well, maybe with this, draw the session to a close. Thank you so much, Charlie, for coming down. So appreciated. We'll try to keep bringing speakers for you to listen to. Next term, winter term, we'll be looking at things from the developing country perspective. Developing country energy, developing country land use. So watch for the announcements on that. Thank you all for coming. Thank you so much.
Yeah, I'll have my time.